sister. Oh, hello again. It's so nice to see you. I have an important new message for you. I am going to tell you to sow a seed of tithe into my ministry. I mean our church. And, if you do that, then I know that God will bless you financially.
Pastor Money Love, do you have any scripture to support your claim that Christians today ought to pay a tithe? And if you do, are you willing to obey the scriptures perfectly and exactly just the way that the Bible teaches it? With absolutely no deviation from the biblical text whatsoever.
Well, I guess so.
No, I guess so will not do. I want a certain yes or no answer. I myself am willing to obey scripture. So, are you also willing to obey scripture perfectly and exactly and tithe just the way that anyone in the Bible tithed? With absolutely no deviation from the biblical text. Don't tell me some pie-in-the-sky testimony. That is a made-up story, which I am supposed to listen to for hours on end.
Okay, yes. I am willing to obey the scriptures.
And, Pastor Money Love, are you willing to do exactly what the scriptures teach? By paying a tithe in the same way that people in the Bible also did?
Okay, yes. I am.
Fine. Then I'm listening. Show me a verse which commands me to tithe today, and remember that we have both agreed to do exactly what the scriptures teach, with absolutely no deviation or any spiritualization of the text whenever it happens to disagree with our own pet theories.
Okay, well, please read Matthew 23:23. We read here that these Pharisees paid a tithe. So sister, if you want to obey scripture, then this verse commands you to pay 10% of your weekly wage to my church.
Hold on. Which things were these Pharisees paying as a tithe?
Their income.
No. Read the text. Which things were these Pharisees paying as a tithe at Matthew 23:23? What does the Bible state that they were tithing?
Well, the tithe, which was money, I guess.
Stop. Matthew 23:23 reads, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you pay a tithe of mint, and anise, and cumin, and have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faith. These you ought to have done, without leaving the others undone." Notice that these tithes are herbs, and not money. So, if you want to obey this verse, just like these Pharisees did, without any spiritualization, just as we agreed, then you must pay a tithe only of your crops, which you happen to grow in your herb garden, if you had one.
Well, it says herbs, but that could mean money in today's society.
Nonsense. They had money in Jesus' day. Judas betrayed Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. Yet the tithe was still herbs and not money. You are dishonestly breaking your agreement to pay a tithe in exactly the same way that people in the Bible tithed. Also, even Abraham had money. See Genesis 20:16, where he received 1,000 pieces of silver. Oh, and by the way, Abraham never tithed on those 1,000 pieces of silver.
Well, if you go to Malachi 3:10, you'll read, sister, that we must bring all the tithes of our income into the storehouse. This means bringing our money into the local church.
You liar. They were paying a tithe of food and not money. This is why Malachi 3:10 reads, "Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house." The Hebrews also had three separate tithes. Firstly, the Levite tithe, which was paid to the tribe of Levi. Secondly, the festival tithe, which the people stored so that they could celebrate the festivals. And thirdly, the poor tithe, which was administered by the tribe of Levi. But the tithe which the priests received here at Malachi 3:10 was the tithe of the tithe of Numbers 18:26. This was the best 10%, which was taken from the first 10% tithe, which the tribe of Levi received as the Levite tithe. Strictly it's an offering, but it was an offering which happened to be yet another tithe. So if you want to obey Malachi 3:10, then tithe food, which you as a member of the tribe of Levi would have just paid to the priests for storage in the Jerusalem temple storerooms.
Yes. Well, but today, we can adapt tithing to our modern culture. so I do obey. Malachi 3:10. But I just take it spiritually, and so I keep it in a new spiritual sense. By receiving money from people, and not food.
You vile thief. You take Malachi 3:10 literally when you accuse people of not paying money into your church. But then, when it suits you, you spiritualize the same texts, such as when anyone uses this text to correct you. Such as your paying out of the tithe to support poor widows and orphans. Or to pay your singers and musicians, as at Nehemiah 13:5. Look! Firstly, Malachi 3:10 states that the tithe was food. Secondly, the children of Israel had to take their Levite and poor tithes to one of the 48 Levitical cities. Numbers 35:7. Do you pay your tithes just like this too? Thirdly, the Levites took the tithe of the tithe to the Jerusalem temple. So because you are not a member of the tribe of Levi, therefore, Malachi 3:10 cannot possibly apply to you.
I rebuke you.
Shut up, you complete and utter moron.
Ah, yes, I've just remembered that Abraham also paid a tithe. He tithed 10% of his money to Melchizedek.
What did you just say?
I said that Abraham tithed 10% of his own money to Melchizedek.
Firstly, he was called Abram at Genesis 14, not Abraham, until a little later. Secondly, you said that he tithed 10% of his own money to Melchizedek. But he didn't tithe any of his own property. He gave 10% of his war booty to Melchizedek. This was a one-off payment, which he made once in his life, and in accordance with the local customs of the time, as a one-off freewill offering. Genesis 14:23 states that he gave the other 90% away as well. But as we both agreed to obey scripture, exactly and without any deviation. So if you wish to pay a tithe, exactly as Abram did, then make a one-off payment, once in your lifetime, of war booty, which you have captured in battle, as you can't tithe of your own property.
But I think that we ought to pay our tithes, because Abraham tithed before the law.
But Abraham offered a burnt offering, at Genesis 22:13. He also kept slaves, who were called bond servants, and they had been bought with money, at Genesis 17:13. And he also circumcised his male family members, at Genesis 17:14. All of this took place centuries before the law was given to Moses, at Mount Sinai. So Pastor Money Love, if tithing is for today, because it was before the law, then by your pathetic reasoning, Christians ought to keep slaves, practice circumcision, and offer up animal sacrifices today.
I think that you are very proud.
Shut up, you dolt.
But Abraham tithed before the law. Doesn't that prove that the tithe is an eternal command?
Look, God sometimes took certain local customs, such as tithing, and then incorporated them with some adaptations into the Mosaic law. At Leviticus 27:30, God redefined the tithe for Israel as food. Also, Israel paid three tithes, two of these tithes to the tribe of Levi. So this was an adaptation of the tithe, which was changed from the local pagan culture when it was incorporated into the Mosaic law. So now, only landowners qualified for the tithe. They paid multiple tithes. And if they did not wish to physically take their tithe to one of the 48 Levitical cities, then Leviticus 27:31 states that they could exchange their tithe for silver and pay their tithe at the rate of 1/8 and not 1/10.
But why can't I decide for myself just how much I would like to tithe? God has given me the freedom to choose for myself. And so I choose to practice the tithe laws as they operated before the law was given.
The post-Mosaic tithe was essentially a tax. And unfortunately, taxes do have to be paid, just as the authorities determine, and not as we would like to choose for ourselves. Look, if you pay the tithe, although like many pastors today, you seem to be far more interested in receiving a tithe than paying a tithe yourself, then you must obey all of the Mosaic law. Look, on a related issue, let me ask you this. Do you keep the Levirate vow, which is another aspect of the Mosaic law?
What is that? I've never heard of it.
In the book of Genesis, many early cultures practiced the Levirate vow, which was this: that if a man died without any children, then the man's brother would have sexual relations with his sister-in-law, in order to then raise up children in his brother's name. At Genesis 38:10, a man called Onan was struck dead by God for not completing sexual intercourse according to the Levirate vow. But God took this principle and then incorporated it into the Mosaic law, with a major adaptation, so that now the man had to legally marry his sister-in-law if the man was a bachelor. See Deuteronomy 25, verses 5-10. Even Jesus never denied Levirate marriage. He approved of it, at Matthew 22:24. So Pastor Money Love, as you are a single man, would you be willing to marry your sister-in-law if she were childless and your brother died? Now I'm certain that your sister-in-law would be extremely disappointed to marry you, as you are so ugly and stupid. But my point is this: if you're going to take Genesis 14 and from this one verse, then claim that tithing is for today, because it was practiced before the law, then why don't you practice Levirate marriage in your church, as that was also commanded before the law was given? At Genesis 38:8.
Video by Robert Skynner.